The last final field that we're going to create is date of birth. So I'm going to key in DOB for the field. I will create data element ZDOB. Use forward navigation to create it. Saving the table along the way and choosing yes to create data element. Enter date of birth data element for the short text. For the domain, once again, enter ZDOB and use forward navigation to create the domain. Choose yes to save the data element. Assign it to the local object. Choose yes to create the domain. Enter some short text. I will enter date of birth. Now for the data type, date of birth is a date field. So we want to choose the appropriate date field from the drop-down box. So press the F4 key to bring up the drop-down box and choose the entry that says DATS. I press the Enter key and you can see an information box has popped up just to tell us the attributes of the DATS field have been assigned to this domain. So just click the Continue box and it's filled in the number of characters for us and the output length. Now the output length is different to the number of characters because it will actually insert the backslash to separate the days, months and years of this field. So activate the object. Assign it to the local object development class. Ensure your domain is selected in the inactive objects window and choose continue. Then check the status bar to ensure everything is activated and saved successfully. Press the F3 key to step back. And on your data elements field, go to field label. We will enter date of birth in every field, but the whole text date of birth does not fit in the short description, so I'm just going to key in DOB. Press enter to automatically fill in the field label length, then activate your data element. Once the object has been activated and saved successfully, press the F3 key to step back. And there we can see all our fields have been entered into our table. All the short text and individual data element and domain properties have come through onto our screen. So that indicates everything is working just fine for us. Now the next thing we want to do is just click the Save button so we can just save our progress up to now. Then we're going to move on to maintain the technical settings for our table. Now SAP needs to know a little bit more information about the table that we are creating before it can create the back-end database tables itself. So you can either now click on the technical setting button on the toolbar or go to the Go to menu and choose the technical settings option, which is Control-Shift-F9. We now need to tell our system what development class we want to use. So if you click the drop-down button, you'll see that we have 5 options to choose from. And if you just read the descriptions, you'll get a flavor of what this is all about. We want to choose the first entry, which is APPL0. Which identifies this table as holding master data in a transparent table. Double click that entry. And then for the size category field, click the drop down again. And here we are just estimating to the system itself how many records we are going to be holding in this table. And it will use these values to make an educated guess of how it should actually create the tables in the underlying database. We're not going to be holding a lot of data in our table, so just choose the first option, which is size category 0. Once selected, now we'll move down to the buffering options. And we want to ensure that buffering not allowed is selected. And what this means is basically do not load the table contents into memory for reading. And this prevents the table from being read in advance of us selecting the records in our programs. So you may be thinking it would be more advantageous to hold the data in memory for speed efficiency, and you'd be quite correct. But in our example, we don't actually need that. If speed was an issue for the development that you were working on, you would most definitely want to be using buffering switched on, which would ensure the data is read into memory. So if you have large tables that are being read very often, but only being updated infrequently, choose this option. That's all we need to fill out on this screen. So you can click the Save button, and then press the Back key. Now if all goes well, we can activate our table and move on to entering records. So click the little matchstick icon to activate your table, and check the status bar at the bottom to ensure everything has worked successfully. In this case, it has. This concludes the fourth video for creating our first database table. In the next video, we're going to look at how we can enter data directly into the table we've just created.